थैंक यू वेरी मच। Okay, so we are live on Facebook now, and it's 12:27. We still have 3 minutes to go, and with this, we welcome everyone who is watching the global listening session on Zoom as well as on Facebook. I would request Dr. Mallikarjun, President of ISCP, to talk to us about ISCP, its activity, and then start this session. Dr. Mallikarjun.
So, good afternoon on behalf of Board of Directors and executive members of Indian Academy of Cerebral Palsy. I welcome all of you to the 24 hours global listening and sharing session. This month, on the occasion of National Cerebral Palsy Day, Indian Academy of Cerebral Palsy has programmed month-long programs. I just share our activities. I'm sorry. Hope are you able to see my sharing? Indian Academy of Cerebral Palsy.
We are not able to share your screen. Please try again. Click on share screen and then.
I have shared, I think.
So no, no, it's not. Share and share again, sir. We are not able to see.
I'm sorry, sir. Is it visible?
No.
Okay.
Not visible.
I think it is taking time. I don't want to waste your time. We have designed month-long program, and every weekend we have programs and scientific as well as social rehabilitation programs. Last week we had a wonderful Meri Kahani, Meri Jabani. Almost 20,000 participants viewed that program. This is a sharing of life journey of persons with a cerebral palsy, and this is a global listening sharing session. We had 2 months back, we had a listening session with the parents. It was a big hit, and this is a second listening sharing session. We joined with the Indian International Academy. Then for the next of coming weeks, we have 4 programs. Now, I welcome Dr. Shashikala Madam to take this session forward. She is a chairperson, and I welcome all speakers on behalf of Indian Academy of Cerebral Palsy, Dr. Shabina Ahmed as a moderator, Dr. Asha Chetnis, Dr. Taral Nagda, Dr. Jitendra Jain, Dr. Sunanda Kolli Roddy, and Divya Karthik and Deval Patak. I request Dr. Shashikala Madam to take this forward. Thank you very much. Shashikala Madam?
Madam, you have to unmute.
Yeah, I'm on mute. Can you hear me now?
We can hear you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to all the participants of the Global Listening Session. I thank both IASCD and IACP for having selected me as the chairperson. The COVID pandemic has been a bolt from the blue for the health domain across the globe. It's been a bigger challenge in developing and middle income countries, where we have both economic and human resource shortage and unpreparedness. But these disadvantages have been overcome by the innovative creations of my colleagues. We are trying to present you a pan-India picture from four zones of India: north, northeast, west, and south, and from different contexts, from a metro clinic-centered approach to a metro outreach program to a real-world rural program, rural setting, and of course an outreach rural setting, so that you can get an idea of what's happening in a developing country. We have overcome our human resource and economic limitations by the zeal, enthusiasm, and innovativeness of my colleagues. I'm very, very pleased to present my Generation Next and, of course, a few of my colleagues. I pass on the mic to my wonderful friend Shabina Ahmed, a developmental pediatrician, to take the program forward.
Okay. Thank you, Shashikala. I'd like to thank IACP for giving me this opportunity to be with you all today. I'm a developmental pediatrician, and we have seen that there has been a real disruption in the rehabilitation process. And I'm very happy that all of us are getting together today to learn things from different perspectives share. So there have been challenges, but there have been opportunities also, and this is a great opportunity of being together to address the different perspectives and different situations. We have six speakers with us today, and each speaker is allotted 6 minutes to give their perspectives, and after that we are going to have a question hour session of 20 minutes. Our whole session is going to be 55 minutes, and I would like all of you to keep your mic in mute, and you can put up your videos, and for the question hour sessions, there's a chat box, and you can place your questions, which we shall take it at the end, and if you need to talk, then at the end, you can put on your video cameras and raise your hands, and I will pick up the questions. So with this, I invite Asha Chitnis to set the ball rolling. She's a pediatric physiotherapist, and she's basically a center, clinic-based, center-based work, and she's associated with a lot of nonprofit organizations. She has a lot of contribution, and I invite you to give us your experiences and regarding the challenges and opportunities you've had during this COVID time. Over to you, Asha Chitnis.
Thank you so much, Shabina Madam. I mean, respected chairpersons, moderators, a great afternoon from India. I speak from Mumbai. This represents my city, which is the financial capital, and our Mumbai stands for love and hope. What I'm going to speak today is the changing landscapes in rehabilitation services with the onset of COVID. I'm going to have two or three hats that I don as a clinician, as a hospital at the NICU, and also as a teacher. What really, really was my problem was when parents who had very small infants and NICU neonates, many were anxious, and one of was my biggest challenge. The other three, four challenges were, how did I remain connected when we were physically apart? How could I coach my caregivers to support basic motor skills, to help them with their behavioral challenges via distance, even with their sensory processing, to learn and assess the whole family and put all this together? Everything was great when the lockdown and the disruption services happened. Look what the mother says. all felt in India, everybody comes more or less on a regular basis for therapy. And the mother says, many mothers said this, it was like getting the freedom of living like a normal child, the luxury of time to explore life in the most normal situations. Hence, they were very fine, but a month or 2 months down the line, when we all connected back to our parents and the therapy team that I had, the first question I asked was, how are you doing? And we did not know what to really expect. I really had, and everybody actually expressed fear, anxiety, lack of mobility and disbelief. I really had to sit down, reflect and remotivate myself. We had periodic Zoom call meetings with my team and parents and kept them motivated. For my team, I had to really guide them towards a different outlook of looking ahead. It was a new lingo for everyone. Physical distancing, working online, safety. Many of my therapists just could not fathom how could we even treat without touching our parents. The other problem that we faced was the social media and the TV. It was pretty traumatizing, and I felt clear, consistent communication was need of the hour. What was the impact on families and individuals with disability? I guess I had to figure out what was essential, we had many challenges, but what the normal looked like. I really had to understand that I would not be able to put my hands on our patients. So working from home, adopting telehealth was what we really needed to look at. We had many debriefing sessions with staffs, parents. What can you do and what you cannot do? What is most important? What is very essential? We used many different platforms like Zoom, Google Meet, Skype, and many ways that we could connect with the family. When I started looking at this, I was really looking at Indian guidelines for pediatric therapists on our website. And what I really found was just this, that when you do any kind of telehealth, please look at standard care, documentation, patient record, your consent to treat, give them the best standard of care and client comfort and competence. When this happened, we all as a group thought of doing a survey to know perceptions and practices of teletherapy for children with special needs. We divided them into four groups. Parents who were already taking telehealth or had telehealth experiences, parents who did not have telehealth experiences, therapists who had telehealth experiences, and therapists who did not have telehealth. What we really learned was very important. 90%, because of time, I can't show you the whole statistical survey, but more than 50 to 60% of our parents who were not undergoing telehealth were against resuming outpatient-based therapy. And the ones who were doing said that it's better to continue safe treatment from home, though there were minor challenges. Therapists who were not providing telehealth had reservations about the same, as it could not replace hands-on therapy. But they were also looking ahead in the future. And therapists who did telehealth, they definitely agreed to continue what they were doing, but they still had a great ambiguity of the future to use telehealth. Having said that, what were the benefits for families and therapists? When I started planning this, I had to really look at what was the best survey that I could really find toys. So I looked at toys, I looked at boxes, I looked at small rolls, I picked up my doll, looked at a revolving chair. We always saw every person in the context and in the environment. I wanted to really build capacities to coach and engage and educate families. It is definitely flexible, soft, safety and cost effective. We use mostly asynchronous and real-time video conferencing. Our problems were some families did not have technology, and we really had to figure out how would we access them, how could we just call them, explain them. The biggest negative that came out of this was for both therapists and parents was we had really lost the personal touch, the social communication was gone, and my family sometimes thought they were the primary caregivers and felt very overwhelmed and responsible for what they had to do. As a therapist, I really had to think out of the box, what is the best practice? How do I do assessments which are reliable and valid? What can be done and what cannot be done remotely? And how do I keep myself updated, measure it, and plan my next challenges? I would do for an example, I would kind of send this video saying, if the child sits like this, that's not a correct posture. These are better ways of using pillows and rolls to do a better posture. For a small child, I would tell them how to carry, how to make them sit. This is for kids who are very involved, where we would make a towel roll out of a cloth and give it to them and kind of work on. So I used to keep sending different videos through whatever possible mediums that I had, and they would send me back, meet on Zoom and kind of carry this on. And that's what we've been doing. And things are pretty well, working pretty well. So if I really come down to conclude my remarks on the Indian scenario and what I have learned, we prepared for the worst, but hoped for the best. I realized that empowering and upskilling of professionals and parents equally is the way forward. And we were very lucky there because we were doing lots of home programs with our parents. And I think so that really helped us in this given time and empowered the parents. I, as a therapist, felt I had to really reinvent my thinking. I had to learn, unlearn, and relearn. We have now many choices as we move ahead because it's face-to-face. Somebody can come one day to my clinic, see, and then continue online. Some prefer home-based, some prefer teleconsultation. And I feel, at least in India, it's very new on the horizon. Telehealth has become and will continue to be an integral part of ongoing clinical care of pediatric patients and their families. I also feel that that's going to be very helpful when I need to really train new therapists and do a lot of teaching. The last thing that I say is we as health professionals, we are continuously in front of the laptops or on the screens. Sometimes there is a brain fatigue, there is a bum sores, there are back sores, and I think so we really need to take care. And at the end, I thank you so much for letting me share my videos. Thank you once again.
Okay. Thank you, Asha, for your wonderful presentation. So now I request Dr. Jitendra Jain, who is the orthopedic surgeon, and he's going to give us his perspective from a hospital-based perspective. And he's also going on his working in an organization called Krishna Foundation. So over to Dr. Jain.
Please make it full screen, Jitendra. Yeah, we can see your screen. Please start. Dr. Jain, you are muted. Please unmute yourself.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is my own experience in the multidisciplinary rehab center in the COVID-19 situations. The impact of COVID-19 on the families and children with cerebral palsy, because all the therapy centers were closed, so no rehab work was done at the rehab center. We are not able to perform any elective surgery because all the hospitals were engaged with the COVID works. Children had to remain inside houses, so there was no interaction with society and all social activities was stopped. Patient and families was very difficult feeling in getting emergency care and new consultation. So they feel very, very insecure about their health. The families also have lots of financial problems because of job insecurity and decline in the business. The parents feel lots of psychological stresses on whole family, especially mother. We closed all our center, stopped doing elective surgery just after the lockdown. Most of the parents who were staying here at Prayagraj were shifted to their native places as they got the permission to go. We started our supervision of the home-based therapy program, who had undergone surgery and botulinum toxin and therapy also. The counseling and consultation was continued through WhatsApp video call, Zoom, Skype, and sometimes short home visit if they required an emergency care. But social distancing was taken care in previously managed children. We also started online consultation because transport was not so possible and no one can come to visit at clinics. The online assessment, consultation, and counseling session was started just after the lockdowns. Before any video consultation and counseling, we asked for all the investigation, prior consultation detail, treatment history, medicine detail, good quality video recording of child activity at WhatsApp message. In this video consultation, we guide them about the home-based activity, ask them to continue till COVID-19 is over, so we were able to save from the surgeries on that times. We also started the online training and supervised activity. In this online training supervised activity, we taken care about the planning which are given according to the ICF model. It started since July 2020. Before starting, we assess the parents' capability of learning, level of education, any previous experience of therapy and need of the child. According to that, we started giving their supervised activity. In some children where disability is too much and problem is too much, they require surgery, we don't give all those consultation activities at line. One-to-one training to parents in activities in ADL was given according to ICF model. This session was only 45 minute session once or twice weekly. the parents can record their all those activity on the online so that they can repeat at home and can do weekly sessions. The feedback and functional change in this child activity is being done at the end of every month. And then all the parents will be taken at the Zoom meeting so that interaction program with the parents can be also be organized. We also started the online training and education for the parents of children with cerebral palsy. It was weekly online live educational sessions in basic to advanced update, which is required by the parental perspectives. It was started in August 2020 after 3 months of the lockdown. It was also telecast on the Facebook page and YouTube simultaneously. We have included a topic to empower the parents for promoting good quality of life in these children. We have taken lots of topic, and still it is continuing. We also started to have interaction program for the parents in the monthly basis. In that parents interaction programs, we have included the parents with long experiences and some parents who have small kids. All the parents were requested to share their experiences, problem, their ways to manage in this COVID-19 time, as well as the normal courses, what they feel, what their psychological status, and how they can be boosted up. It gave us lots of valuable information about lifetime care of this individual. This is the live interactive session on social media to motivate other parents. This has benefited thousands of parents who are viewing all those sessions. This online program has given lots of positive response also in this COVID-19 session when all the parents were locked inside the home. The regular interaction with the family keep their morale high. We were able to increase their confidence, able to motivate them in improving quality of life, engaging them in more functional activity. Deterioration has been prevented because they are not able to get lots of intervention like surgery and botulinum toxin. We were able to increase the level of their knowledge about care of these children. Regular guidance was provided to the parents. It opened the opportunity, even after the lockdown period will be open, to reach remote places and for working parents, because most of the working parents are free at Saturday and Sunday. It provides them all this online program so that they can do at home. The positive impact of lockdown also there, in spite of being the negative impacts, both parents remain at home because they work from home. They can abandon their now the better understanding of their own child. Whole family is involved, especially the father at this time of the lockdown, because all the family are together at the home. There is now more concentration as we focus on the family-centered program. Initially, we are started at rehab center. All the parents have to stay at one place for the therapy. They become more techno-friendly, though easy to teach them. The parents develop more interest in learning. It generates more interest in parents to have complete knowledge about the child with CP by the online availability of scientific material. We have started using the ICF borderline 5-word. We have also translated in Hindi that all these things have been utilized in online training and programs. Thanks for nice learning. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Jitendra Jain, for being in time. And your impact, your parent empowerment programs has been, I think, very, very good. Thank you very much. So I now call upon Dr. Divya. Yeah. So Dr. Divya, she is a physiotherapist, pediatric physiotherapist, and her main area of work is her outreach programs to the community. So over to you, Divya.
Yes.
And you'll be talking mainly on what's working in Karnataka.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, and good afternoon to everyone. I thank ISCP for this opportunity. So I, who belong to the socio-economic background, Bota, which is the southern part of India, and I'm from Bangalore. So during when both were apprehensive, we had so much of fear and anxiety about COVID and what's going to happen. We were clueless on lockdown. Everything was actually new. But the perspective of parents from the rural villages, urban slums were a little different. It was different. So when we called the parent during the lockdown time, the first thing at the parents of the rural villages wanted to know about was the information on COVID, what is COVID, what are the effects of COVID can have on their child,
will their child be affected disability to wear a mask? Will the child be difficulty to go out? So these were the major concerns, along with none of these parents at the rural villages had any of the medical supplies, be it anti-epileptic drugs or the therapy services. So most of them were a little concerned on what will happen if these drugs were not procured on time or not given on time, what will happen to these children? So this was a major concern from the rural villages. Then came to livelihood. Over a period of time, when the second lockdown was announced, people started worrying about livelihood, what will happen, and then education and also the socialization of the children, because most of them had a lot of behavioral issues, not only children with disability, even with a typical child. But when it came to urban slums, the scenario was different. When we called them for the first time, the first thing they told us was they had lost their jobs. 90% of our families had lost their jobs because most of them were daily wage laborers. And also abuse, physical abuse, domestic abuse, both to the women and to the child with disability or other children. To be very honest with you all, at the urban slum, the families, the priority of child with disabilities was on the last list. Their priorities were much more different. The needs were much more different in the urban slums compared to the rural villages. Rural villages, people actually had concern on their child, but in urban slum, the poverty had taken over, loss of job had taken over the services, so their children was not on their priority. So as a therapist, we ourselves did not know from where to start, how to start, but we knew that we had to address the needs of the children and the family. So our COVID response was the entire program for the last 5 or 6 years was fortunately designed to empower the parent and also the government stakeholders. So the parents who have been in our program for a couple of years knew how to do the early stimulation activities. And so the lockdown did not affect much. So they were able to carry out the early stimulation activities to ensure that the child is functionally efficient. And the government stakeholders, we did a lot of empowerment for the ASHA workers, the Anganwadi workers. These are frontline government public health stakeholders. So during lockdown, when they were posted on COVID duties, apart from the regular work, they were able to connect and with these children and these families and ensure the needs of these children and families are met. Apart from that, we used to have one face-to-face meeting with all of them, which turned down to scheduled phone and video calls. And we also formed a WhatsApp group with the parents. These WhatsApp groups were not formed to teach any early stimulation activities. That was done through a scheduled one-to-one online and phone and video calls. WhatsApp groups were basically formed for parents to share their videos so that they could motivate each other to share how they're using local resources and doing activities for the children, and also their concerns and their needs. And it was beautiful to see how one family could help the other family during the lockdown. It could be in terms of getting them the medicines, in terms of taking them to the hospital, or teaching them going to their particular house to teach them the activities they know. So it was a great group, and this has helped for us to strengthen the parent champions and self-help groups. So parent champions have emerged who do a lot of policy and advocacy to ensure the needs of these children are met in the particular geography. So we have about 30 WhatsApp group, around 2,000 parents in these groups in various geographies of Karnataka. And we also did a lot of webinars, which was live streamed on our YouTube channel for a wider reach. It was basically for parents, but all the government stakeholders and doctors in the particular geography also were part of these webinars. We also realized that it was very important for us to address the needs of the families for the well-being of the child and the child with disability community, be it to another NGO in terms of providing survival kits, orientation kits, jobs. We also connected them to the district mental health program where psychiatrists and psychologists were giving counseling, and also the NGOs. And a lot of government schemes, which was launched during the lockdown and for the lockdown period to assist them in financial stability. But we did have challenges. The main challenge was in providing activities was for the newly identified or the newly enrolled children. Children who enrolled in the program in January, February, parents were not actually able to cope up with the online classes or the online sessions. They did require a lot of, they wanted to have a lot of face-to-face sessions. We did also have a technological and internet issues. And unfortunately, in the month of late March and early April, 42 children in our project died. This was basically because they didn't have timely access to the hospital. Most of them did die of respiratory conditions, and the immunizations were not done. And mental well-being of the entire family members was a big challenge, and it's a challenge even today, because they have so many other needs and the priorities have completely changed. The scenario has completely changed. It's not like an urban setup. People are struggling even for a single day meal, and to have a child with disability and also have other children and their family members, there's a lot of stress. So they're not able to give an appropriate time or the most efficient time for children with disabilities. So a lot of counseling sessions are being on for these parents and family care members. Poverty, another big issue is poverty, both at the urban slums. It's really the scenario is completely different. Rural villages are much better, I would say. Urban slums are, the situation is really hard because things have not got back to normal at the urban slums. Socialization and education, again, children are having behavioral issues, and parents and are worried about what will happen to the education. And even when I say education, it was actually parents and families had a 4 to 5 hours of free time where they could get their own time when the children were enrolled into schools. Since that is not there, I think the mental stress is also increased for the family and the caregivers. And for the last 6 months, there is an alarming increase of a referral of malnourishment children across in urban slums and the rural villages. So the malnourishment in children have increased. So that's a challenge, and that's a thing we have to work upon. And I would like to just say there were a lot of learnings. The way forward will definitely be, fortunately for a country like India, the internet has reached to the rural villages. So we have to use, we have to leverage the use of technology. And so it's actually used. Yes, ma'am?
Yes, it's okay.
And so that it's reached and to empower the ecosystem. Yeah, just a few seconds. The concept and the components of ICF is applied and practiced in the community. And I would like to end by saying the community ownership should be there. The community has to own and they have to voice the needs of the child with disability. And I think we need to strengthen both the ecosystem and the community ownership. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Divya, for your wonderful presentation. We conclude is that you have had wonderful, innovative ideas of connectivity and continuity of service. And what I'm very happy is about the, you have highlighted the disruption of the medical services, because along with the rehabilitation process, we have to think about the medical services. Okay, so thank you very much. So next we invite Dr. Deval Pathak. She is a pediatric occupational therapist, and her work is mainly in the Western Zone in Gujarat. And this is an outreach program, and she's going to give us the community perspectives of a rural setting. Over to the rest.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon and hello, everyone. I'm Deval Pathak, working in JR Rehabilitation Institute and Research Center in Kutch, Gujarat, rural India. Very well shared the experience and the challenges by the doctors and the physiotherapists. Now I will share my challenges, what I have got in this rural India.
Changes. Well, click on the screen and then press next.
Okay, sir. Yeah. So here are the various challenges what we have been suffering here, like poor awareness of the pandemic. As we all know, the first pandemic affected the urban areas more and less the rural areas. So people didn't get the sincereness of the disease, first of all. So there is the poor awareness of the pandemic here. Next is the illiteracy. Because of the illiteracy, they couldn't understand the hygiene and how to take the precautions and the what are the safety measures and everything. So they couldn't compete with these safety measures here. After that, it is a deterioration of the condition of the child. Because they become the homebound, the mother or the parent couldn't do any therapy for the children, and the child's condition is deteriorating, or maybe the progress has been steady. After that, the non-acceptance of the therapist with the safety measures. What happened when we wear the surgeon's mask and the shields and everything? Child was not ready to accept us. Even if he sees us, then he's finding we are the alien from somewhere. So he's not ready to accept that therapy from us. Then the unavailability of the expertise in the rural areas. Because of the transport issues and the lockdown and all, the expert couldn't come to the rural area. and they couldn't service the rural area. So how the solutions, what we found the solution out of it, we created the awareness of the parents. We make them understand what is this pandemic is going on and how we are being affected by the COVID-19 and what we should do and how we can do the precautions and safety. Though it has been showing in the TV and by the government and everything, but their awareness was not there. So we need to teach them what are the awareness you're supposed to do and what are the precautions you're supposed to take. Deteriorations of the child, so we ask them to do the therapy at home, however you can involve in it and you can do at home, how we can support you. So you take the precautions and try to come. Because after the 1 month, we can give the therapy to the children, but there was a problem, the precautions they were not taking. So we can't take them in the hospitals or the therapy centers. When they come to the therapy, as I explained, that non-acceptance with the safety measures, they were not ready. So we promoted different methods to acceptance. And the unavailability of the expertise in the rural area, we try to start the telehealth from the center to the expertise, not from the therapy to the directly to the patient or anything, but we started from the center to the expertise. And there are some negative effects as well because of the lack of social interaction and the group of play, depression due to deteriorations of the child. Mother feels that kid can't get in the therapy, he is not getting not any improvement or the progress is not there, therapy is not being done. So these are the problems we got. And how we created the awareness of the safety precautions. We tried to explain them by the song or make them understand by the rhymes and everything. And we sing with them, we promoted them to wear the mask and we did the distribution of the mask and everything. And that's how we promoted child to wear the mask first of all. So when they come for the therapy, they can come safe. Then we treated how to wear the mask, before wearing the mask, what you want to do and how you can do it with the sanitizer and all. So these are the awareness we created in the children as well as with the parents. Before they come for the therapy, we screen and we ask for the travel history or the family member or anyone has gone to travel or anywhere. So every history or if they have any symptoms, then we can stop there and there and we don't take them for therapy. So others, they don't get affected by it. Then there are some few children, they couldn't get the, like they don't want to wear the mask at all. Non-acceptance, totally. They don't find anything wearing by their mouth or anything. They don't like it at all to wear on their mouth. So for that, we need to create something, promoting. How we promoted? We promoted them with the surgical mask attached with some funny mask. When they see that funny mask, they are ready, they are happy, they are feeling that, okay, this is something new, it's fun, we can do it. Then we give it to them, we distributed some funny mask to them, and they are ready to do the exercise. But there is other problem also. Still, we are wearing that shield and the mask, they are not ready to accept us. So we as well tried to wear some funny mask and give them treatment. So it was both funny session was going and they were getting the therapy. For doing the therapy, we maintain quite a good social distance, 8 to 9 feet away from the therapist. Each therapist is away. Very, very, very well ventilated room and very big room. For that, giving the therapy such instrument or anything, we sanitize them properly. And then we put the sheet, which we can spread on the bolster or the wedge or something like. And then it is a use and throw. So we can use some other. For that, even we involve the parent as well in the cognitive or more in therapy. So under the supervision of the therapist, even parent involvement, we came with it. Then for the telehealth, what we can do, we started from our center to the expertise, post-operative patients or the post-botox patients with the surgeon team, and web consultation of the new patients for the different type of therapy, if we can start with the children or anything. Then for the orthosis or for the assistive devices, we ask them on the web consulting for the experts. And whoever was taking the treatment here, they migrated to their native because of this pandemic time period. So we try to contact them on the telehealth, and then we ask their local therapist there that what we can do best for them and how we can help. We explain what we were doing for the child, and then the local therapist can continue doing the therapy for the children. So these are the some various challenges we come across and try to do the solution the way we can do it here, best of our way. When child was ready to wear the mask, we distributed with the some cartoon mask and everything. Child was ready and trying to come to the therapy session. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you, Dr. Deval, for the wonderful presentation. And what we get from your presentation is, since the approach is through rural, the tele rehab may not be possible for every individual. This is one. And secondly, I appreciate your focus on the safety measures that you have taken. I think that is in a very unique way you have done it. And this is very, very important, because when we give our rehabilitation services, we have to be in sync with what others are doing. And this is where that our community also can contribute to the safety measures. So this is where the responsibility lies. Okay, thank you very much. So now I call upon Dr. Sunanda Kohli. She's a developmental pediatrician. And she's from basically from Delhi, but her services are very unique because it is through a community initiated service. So it's she has got the community to work to contribute and to help themselves. Over to you, Sunanda.
Thank you, Shabina. Greetings to all from Delhi, and I thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present my perspectives amidst the kaleidoscope of perspectives from India. I shall focus on community-based inclusive development and what we learned from caregivers in the community. COVID-19 left nobody untouched. While COVID-19 left nobody untouched, it was the young children who were the most affected. The pandemic also laid bare the inequities in society. For all of us working with children with special needs in the intersectionality of multiple vulnerabilities, by which I mean poverty and the correlates of poverty where parents were not very literate, and the urban slum comes with its own problems. And with all these, we actually realized that some of the changes that affected people most were disruption of public services on which the poor greatly depended. There was an altered magnitude of demand and supply of health and rehabilitation services amid stigma and fear. And there was a lot of unmet support needs for the families in the community because of physical distancing. For instance, immunization services or nutrition supplementation programs, these were all not available. Civil society, including community-based organizations, had to deal with a lot of uncertainties, and we had to repurpose our workforce. Financial distress, and of course the low resilience of parents in such community settings also saw some children experiencing violence, abuse, and toxic stress. Migration in the midst of all this uprooted some families, and this deprived many children the benefits of nutrition through our ICDS services. And we know that children need these most during the critical periods of life when the neuronal structure of the brain is developing. As for the child health workers, there were additional challenges because children remained at home and the physical distance was a necessity. So people were actually trying to figure out how to continue with the services. But I think one advantage we had in the community-based inclusive development framework is that we were already training the parents. There were a lot of families, and including the siblings, who were helping the child within the ICF framework. So they were learning to get innovative as well as to build participatory learning for families. And we saw some integrated interventions. The most notable experience of the period for us was the shared learning that came across in addressing the challenges to the care and development of all children. Some of the important challenges have already been outlined by the speakers who preceded me. The difficulties that children face in understanding the new normal when services stopped, that coupled with the different ways in which these children process information was a major challenge. Wherever there were inadequate social supports, and as somebody mentioned, the urban areas, the social support is inadequate. We were seeing behavioral problems in the older children. Even among adults, the paucity information and disinformation was not very helpful at that period of time, and fighting stigma, fear, prejudice became very important. Disruption of transport services added to the difficulties to access, sometimes even in an emergency such as status. Adapting to digital communication and alternate modes was a challenge for the health workers. But all challenges come with opportunities. And for us, the most important was that people came together in solidarity across the globe, not just in the community. Community support and collaborations to link with families and civil society supporting self-help groups. This was a very good opportunity for that. And internationally also, UNICEF and other stakeholders in childcare began to position health, rehabilitation, education, and social protection in the SDG framework, which meant that a lot of public-private partnerships came together to create infrastructure to utilize resources. There was an opportunity for research, especially long-term studies on children in different contexts, and of course, health, education, everything. Among the shared learnings, we learned that there's no single perfect response. We need context-specific adaptations. Toolkits for families and care providers have to be developed in a variety of functional levels, because now the face-to-face delivery was the norm earlier, and closure of preschools, schools, clinics, rehab centers created that challenge of how to address these. And we realized that physical distancing need not be emotional distancing, but it was important to understand what children need and use the ecological model to see that the neighborhood and wider support systems were available closer home. Communication was the key to help people overcome anxieties and fear, because social isolation and ignorance, as well as disinformation, were major challenges. Our health workers learned to become communicators, and there's a need to become communicators. We're all learning to leverage technology to communicate is now a mantra. There were innovations, integrated interventions were being delivered by experienced teams already building the capacity of key care providers. Activities were now built to daily routines and play to contribute to comprehensive child development. Apart from the tele-learning, tele-consultation, tele-guidance, and there were a lot of other things that even simple instructions by WhatsApp and phone were used wherever connectivity was not a problem. Training modalities, even for the higher rung of the staff, was changing through group teaching sessions, webinars. Beyond technology-aided learning, we actually witnessed some very creative, cost-effective ways to help child development, and home innovations meant that siblings and other children in the extended family could also contribute to inclusive activities and participations. Here in the slide, you see a child whose hand function is being improved using a skipping rope attached to a door handle, and it was the idea of the mother. And so the way ahead now is that we still don't have the COVID phase behind us. We need to still think beyond COVID. The pandemic brought home the need to rethink systems, social justice, equity, governance, and society as a whole if our children need to see the fruits of development. The effects on the most vulnerable communities and children with disabilities in particular depends on how inclusive we are. I have not been referring too much to only children with disabilities, because in our family-centered services, we realize that a child with disability cannot fare much better than the child without disabilities in the same family and the community. So we need to get very inclusive. We also need to see health for all become truly inclusive as defined by WHO. We need to look beyond healthcare in hospital settings. We need to look at prevention, health promotion, rehabilitation, and palliation. Integrated child development policies must address the needs of children with disabilities, and public health systems must be redesigned to ensure uninterrupted services through strengthened primary health care. Health workers assigned to early child care and development, including Anganwadi workers and school services, now should think of becoming broad-based to universalize welfare schemes, but we also need to engage in other dimensions of work, such as child protection. And this would be in the rights-based approach of UNCRPD. So to end, I would say preparing for the future means that we must all get together in our advocacy to act now. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Saranda, for the wonderful presentation. What we learned from your presentation is that the parent responsibility and parent participation should be encouraged. And probably that is the need of the hour. And shared learning and knowledge and the flexibility that we need to bring in our rehabilitation services has been very well highlighted. And it has to be context specific. And that gives us the flexibility in our services. And we were all afraid that there is so much of social distancing, what is going to happen? But it is not emotional distancing. It is only a way of contributing to mitigation of our problems. And I'm happy about the public health policies that probably will need to change, and how we look into our services have to change. So thank you very much, Ananda. And over to Dr. Karal Magda. And we would like his reflections and lessons learned during this program. He's a pediatric orthopedic surgeon, and he's from the suburban area of Mumbai.
So good afternoon, everyone. And of course, good evening to people who are in Australia, and good morning from those from Europe. Arnab, good morning to you. So these are reflections and lessons learned in the pandemic times. And what I'll do is, before I start my talk, what I really want to do is take a situation audit. And I'm going to launch this poll, and I would request everyone to press their choices. What was your reflection to pandemic, and was it added to problem? Did it increase miseries for professional and patients? It was difficult, but we managed, or was it an opportunity to reinvent yourself? And please poll. I can see the number is rising, same as Corona graph. More and more people are polling here, and I'm going to end this in 2 seconds exactly. And here are the results. I am sharing these results. So 59% felt that it was an opportunity to reinvent. 43% felt that it was difficult, but somehow we sailed through and managed. 16% feel it increased the misery, and only 8% felt it added to the problem. So, not bad, because though this was a difficult situation, we all did manage it very well. And coming back to my presentation, that what were my reflections? So when, this whole lockdown started, it was sudden, and it was not expected to last for such a long time. The whole life came to a standstill. There were no patients. The patients did not have doctors. Doctors did not have patients. We really didn't know what was happening to patients. We had Botox or who had undergone surgeries. Patients who were from remote areas, we didn't know how we were going to communicate with them. About our residents and trainees, we really didn't know how we were going to teach them, because there were no patients and there were no classrooms. And in this, sort of a situation, whether it was lifeless situation, suddenly we needed some energy, some ATP. And this ATP for me came in 3 directions. One was academics, second was telemedicine, and third was personal growth. And this was reinvention of my own self. So of course, academics, there were webinars. We started IACP webinars, completed 8 webinars, and they had excellent attendance. We did work on some research papers, got some papers which were just holding on for last many years, current concept reviews, research papers, review articles, they got published, went into new ways of teaching, like WhatsApp discussion, have a group of therapists and keep on discussing things with them, have a group of residents and day-to-day discuss cases. And we also did online courses, one GATE course with World Federation of Neurorehabilitation, and online spasticity management course, which went on for 8 sessions. So these were all new things which I would have never tried. I didn't have time to try this, but I could do it during this pandemic. And of course, this happened with help of a lot of people, and we all came together. People from different parts of India, people from different parts of the world came together to make this happen. The second thing what happened was telemedicine, which everyone has spoken about, but just going beyond consultation and follow-up, we actually arranged telecamps. So doctors in Dehradun who did not know how to manage CP, had questions, could reach out to us, like how they will manage. We were able to help her NGO at Bidara, a small center where I would normally would have to travel for 18 hours by train to reach. Here in 5 minutes, I was there by Zoom. So a lot of changes happened. We had discussion with a center in Bangladesh where a local orthopedic surgeon who discussed case with us, and we were discussing with doctors in Brazil, in different countries. So similar situations, how do people manage in different ways? And this all happened during pandemic. And lastly, it was personal growth. And I think IACP is responsible for that. And IACP is not Indian Academy of Cerebral Palsy. I is innovation. A is alternative lifestyle, eating good food, regular habits, sleeping well. This was first time in life I've actually slept 8 hours every day for last few months, which I've never done in my life. Calming, spirituality, happening through pranayama and yoga, and most important, priority to your own self. Putting yourself before patients, putting yourself before family, and your own health. And this was never a priority for me, but it happened during this time. So this was my work-life balance. Before Corona, my work, was stressful. I used to have extended hours of work and used to look forward to Sundays where I would play, go to my farmhouse, and that was life. In Corona time, it completely reversed. Being at home was work because I had to, take part in the homework, and it was really stressful for me. And seeing patients, meeting them, doing teleconsultation and chatting with them actually became my life. And this was the change this pandemic brought about for me. So I thank Corona for, getting the realities of life across to us and making us know what it is. And I'm sure it is going to, pave way for a lot of changes, even in the field of rehabilitation for children. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Karal, for the wonderful presentation. And what I'm very happy is about the acronym of IACP being turned into so much of positivity. And this is the balance of work and life, is you can see through the acronym of IACP being named differently. Then comes the your focus on your knowledge sharing has been wonderful, because the flexibility and use of multiple portals. So that has been a very enlightening for all of us, and the easy reach. Rightly said that now children don't need to travel, parents don't need to take prior appointments, long waits of appointments. And hence, it has been easier in many, many ways. So as Dr. Asha Chitty said, it is the hybrid way, probably, is the way forward to this. Thank you very much for the wonderful presentations. So now, I would like to sum up what we have learned, that certainly during the COVID times, there was a pause. There was a pause, there was a disruption. But the fact is that none of us waited. And by the feedback, the scores that we saw, 59% came back saying, we are going to fight back. it was only 8% who was discouraged. So this, in fact, says our resilience, professionals' resilience to giving the services. So what we learned from this is that power and parent empowerment programs probably is the need of the day. Parent participation will help in the rehabilitation services. Naturalistic environment is something that we have to look for instead of having centers with particular apparatus. Then we come ICF framework application. If it is kept in mind in centers as well as at home, we are going to give our best services to them. So there is nothing that can disrupt. And knowledge distribution has been a very wonderful way out. But what we find is that probably now we have to go into a little bit of standardization of the TLM material, teaching learning material, which can be given to all professionals. So that's standardization. And the training of health professionals probably has become easier. But the only problem is probably depends on how much help they need. So now over to the participants for their questions. So we have some questions here. The first question has come from Kavita. Kavita, she wants that, is there any TLM for CP and hearing? So probably she is talking about online TLM. So who will be talking on? Shashi, can you take over this? Your audio, can you unmute yourself, please, Shashi? Yeah.
Actually, ma'am, if she's asking in terms of TLM, in terms of speech therapy, we really need to look at what is she asking. Is she asking for apps? Is something that can be made by yourself at home? And for which kind of kids? I agree it's CP, but non-verbal, verbal, what? So, I mean, those things we have to really look at. But there are many, many maps, apps available, you know, that she can use.
Absolutely.
Now, most of my patients are beginning to use YouTube speech therapy, which is available in YouTube. So there are multiple apps actually which are available. Would you like to say something, Shashi?
Absolutely. You see, the problem with many of the apps are not in local languages. So I think that's one area that we all need to work with our speech therapists. Convert many of these apps into local languages. Language distribution, language disparity, apart from the social inequity, is a big, big problem in our country. I think that would be one future direction for research to all of us.
Absolutely. And ma'am, where people are saying that there is no communication and no smartphones and things available, you could actually make these things by, we can teach parents how we can make it with paper and pencil. So that also can be done.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Good old methods of teaching, absolutely. You know, even blackboard teaching, get back to your blackboard and chalk times and
slate,
then do it.
Pencil and slate can go back.
Pencil and slate or blackboard, whatever you want. At the end of the day, we need to have creative and innovative mind. That's the only thing that we need.
Has been a concern by Sharik Khan. He has been wondering that will tele-rehab give a wrong perception that the parents are can work without therapists? So that has been a concern. So maybe we can, whom can we ask? We can ask Asha, because she's been working through tele-consultation mainly. What do you think?
What is that, ma'am? I couldn't hear you, please.
There's a concern regarding will tele-rehab give a wrong perception that the parents can continue without therapists?
I don't think, not at all. I just feel that's what I said. We need to adopt as therapists what are the best practices how we can validate what you're doing. See, that's why we really looked at research. There are, sorry, survey. So I feel it's, you are only going to, and it depends on which parents you teach. Understanding a parent is very, very important. And I think so in my practice, the most important thing that we need to really look at is many therapists should have and should be doing home programs. If they had done home programs throughout their time, things are going to be so very easy for parents to pick up. We do will have problems when we look at new kids, because the hands-on assessment is not going to be there. But in the given time, with so much of fear of COVID, there are parents not willing to even come out. We've yet not started our clinic. So we'll have to really be very innovative and be very cautious at the same time to get the best to the parents. That's what I feel.
Yeah. Can I add on a little, Shabina?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. See, it's not only home program. Wherever it is possible, we must train parents to feel they're competent when they come to us regularly. Building on the sense of competency in, among parents is extremely important. You know, that will help us tide over these kinds of unexpected pandemics. So it needs lots of skill, local language understanding, and understanding the type of families, you know, and their competence.
So we must all remember that the child spends just about 1,000 hours a year, hours in a year with us, and the rest of it is all spent along with the parents. So the parents need to be really empowered, and they must we must impress on that. So we do not lose out on teaching them. Okay. Now the next question is, somebody was worried that will all sleepy children learn even if IQ is low? So, Fernanda?
I think here all children will learn irrespective of whether they have CP or some other problem. It's only that the way they learn may be different, the pace at which they learn is different, depending on the type of impairment they have, the severity, and the circumstances in which they live. But in our experience, CP children are no exception to learning, and many of them have very average to high intelligence. And sometimes people looking at them may not understand, but these children are able to pick up a lot of things from their environment, even in those who are very non-verbal. We just need to understand that child and prepare individualized education plan for these children, plus give a very good social support and team support. In our experience of helping children with cerebral palsy, what we see is while we do our best for all children, in fact, we use some very scientific principles in reaching out to them. Yet there are some children who do better than the rest for the same degree of severity. And here is where the family comes in. We see that when the family support is strong, the family is able to give reasonable accommodation, the parents are understanding, this child can learn a lot. Like in the picture that I showed, the mother was a graduate, and she knew how to actually innovate over what she just picked up in 2 sessions of training before the lockdown. And, so that was the reason I put that photo. That was a child with a CP with a slightly low vision, but poor right-hand function. And you saw beautifully what was happening. All CP children can learn, and our school results have been showing that many of them have successfully passed school examinations, and they're very many now entering higher education and universities doing very well in life.
Ma'am, Rupesh here. I would like to add a little bit to what ma'am said now. Yes, the question about CP with low intelligence, yes, there might be some hiccups compared to the children with no intellectual impairments, but that should not stop anybody from trying how much it can go. Again, it depends upon how much is IQ, but at the same time, what matters is, okay, it might take little bit more effort, little bit more, like some more trial, some more training, and plus with added extra different types of training, what we say is multimodal training. If one modality is not enough, we should include all modalities, say, for example, speech, or like, for example, visual, auditory, tactile and use the play option, play way method to train them. So it's also basically what to sum it up, it's in terms of how what kind of training they can give, multimodal training and extra training. If other children will might take like 5 to 10 trials of learning, children with intellectual impairment, again, depending upon the type of impairment, like extent and degree of impairment, they may take, say, for example, 20 to 40, like that kind of that amount of trials. So it is possible they can learn. It only depends upon how much we train and yeah, multimodal approach.
We can add also as per the UNCRPD and Rights of Disability Act, Persons with the Rights of Disability Act 2016, all degrees of IQ or irrespective of any disability, they are eligible for education. They can walk into any normal school. And now we talk on integrated education system. So no school can deny their admission. It is a child's right in which school he wish to attend, whether he would like to attend the special school or a normal school. I can't impose, but they are eligible, irrespective of their IQ levels.
Thank you, Dr. Manikandan. Now, I just want to add to this that our concern for all children should be that how early we start our intervention, because none of us as parents, as professionals, should lose the window period of development, and that is the first 1,000 days of life. So our focus must be, we're not going to worry about what the IQ of the child is, what is the developmental level of the child, but our focus must be, the stimulation must be in the best way possible in the first 1,000 days of life, and take the opportunity of neuroplasticity of the brain. Okay, so there is another question.
We have time.
From Ashish. He's worried about, and he wanted to know that 42 children died, and what could be the causes that were identified. I think I'd ask Dr. Divya to talk to that, please.
Yes, ma'am. These 42 children had unfortunately died during the early period of lockdown. Most of them because of pneumonia or other respiratory conditions, not COVID. The reason was they were denied the service because there was a lot of stigma attached to the COVID ban. The natural really seen whether the first event was the reason why those children died, but that didn't happen for the last 4 months. It was in the initial periods of lockdown. That was the reason. It was malnourishment was not the cause of death.
So it's very necessary that we all put in our minds for the vaccination of children during this time. Okay, thank you. Now another question has come up, that there seems to be non-COVID comorbidity more than COVID morbidity in children.
Absolutely.
How much has been your experience, Shashkara?
Plenty. In fact, I was about to raise this issue. COVID has not been a problem to us. It's other comorbidities. The instance of COVID in special children, at least in the state of Karnataka and Bangalore, has been very low. But, because of the inaccessibility of health services, problems like particularly epilepsy, respiratory infections, breakage of assistive technologies, and some of the children who have hydrocephalus, the drainage pump getting blocked. So these are all emergency issues, health issues, and status epilepticus particularly has been a big worry to us. And the other thing I would say is, apart from cerebral palsy, we are having a lot more problems with children with ADHD and autism. It's not that just children with cerebral palsy are coming to us. That's an area and which should concern us, because behavioral problems are always very, very challenging, and the challenges have become multiplied during this period. Last but not the least, I'm very worried about the lack of support to the adults with all disabilities. I see, I'm one of the transitional experts in the country. I see a lot of them, even those who are working, having a lot of problems because of social distancing, extended hours of work at home, you know, lack of exercise, gyms being closed. So there's plenty for us to look at, you know, post-COVID area and post-COVID effects. I'm worried that we'll get back our children in a few months' time with worse, maybe contractures, a lot of things, decline, cognitive decline because of epilepsy. So the future is not rosy. COVID is not going to go away anywhere. It's going to be here for some more time. So friends, it's all for us to join our hands, as Dr. Sunanda said, and then build an emotional distancing, rather break the emotional distancing with our parents and build a better inclusive society, right?
Thank you. And may I add to that, that we have to think about the new behavioral issues that are arising in children. So this is something when we do our rehabilitation process, we need to ask about emergence of any new behavior. That is going to give us some clue to, is there abuse going on in the child, or is the child has not been able to cope up with the new situation? So this is one thing that we need to keep in mind, and the mental health of adults that needs to be also seen. So these are two other issues that we really need to have concern. Okay, so we have covered almost all the questions. There are some of the participants, they want the emails of the panelists. We shall send them to you, and then the websites. And I've got one information from Professor Alicia that there is a request for a presentation of abstracts in the focus symposium of current controversies and debate on children of disability. So, and she, a website has been given, bettertogether2022.org. So I would request all the participants to log into this website and look into this focus symposium on current debates. And then there is also a request from the participants that blueprint must be available for telecare. So this is probably one thing that we need to work on, and in regional language, that would be wonderful. Any other things, any comments?
Shabina, I must also voice here that in teletherapy, there is no legality for demonstrating exercises. This is again an area all of us have to work on so that we have legality and governmental support for demonstrating exercises, particularly for new parents whose efficacy and competency we do not know. And I really admired Asha for having shown it on the dolls. Thank you so much, Asha. It's a very innovative idea. It's a very innovative idea.
And I just want to add that Arnab Seel has mentioned that he would like to have in the chat box about innovations and things. Whatever, sir, whatever you require from our group, we are definitely ready to give anything that is required. And you can write to the president and we will share everything that we could be of any help. Thank you so much. Special thanks to Elisa for helping us with everything that is going on behalf of all our speakers. Thank you so much.
On behalf of all of first, I would like to thank Children with a Cerebral Palsy. Because of them, I am here. And first, I thank Professor Hans and Dr. Arnab Seel for providing us an opportunity. Alicia and Dr. Jenny for handholding to take this forward, the 24 hours global session. And I thank special thanks to Dr. Shabina Ahmed for accepting our consent. In a short notice, though, she is on vacation at Netherlands. She made up for thank you very much, madam, and Dr. Rupesh Kumar for a busy schedule. With the despite of his busy schedule, he has given his consent to be a resource person for this global session. And I thank all my speakers for giving a wonderful challenges to the sharing their challenges and solutions. And thank on behalf of all of our founder members and directors and EB members, I thank Dr. Arnab Sale, and we missed him. We wanted to have his session, this month-long programs we designed. We request all of you to join. We had a wonderful session of the on Achievers Journey. The 13 speakers shared their journey and their success with all of us. It is very inspiring. And tomorrow we are going to have a After Us What? Most of the parents worry on After Us What? So we will be having that webinar on 10th of October. I request all of you to join, and we follow the ICF. All this work is done on the basis of ICF, which my F words. Our theme is also my F word for this month, World's National Cerebral Palsy Day celebration. We thank Alicia, Jenny, and Dr. Arnab Seel, and Dr. Hans, all the IAACD officials who are working round the clock to make this global session successful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I request all the panelists for a big smile and a group photograph. So again, things have changed, and photographs are really not possible they used to be done. But let's, Deval, please look here. Yeah.
Look here. Yeah. Open, you want the smile,
Taral? Big smile. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Taral.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thanks to everybody.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye. Thank you, ma'am. See you.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you so much. Thanks. Dr. Taral for recording. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Alicia. Bye.
Alicia, do you want me to end this meeting? What should I do? No.